I want to let you guys know just how I met Obi personally. Towards the beginning of 2020, I was living out in Silver Lake, Los Angeles, filming the Netflix show Country Comfort. And Obi actually happened to live a couple blocks from my house. And one day while I was running with my dad and my brother, we came across a man in a wheelchair doing what seemed to be quite incredible wheelchair calisthenics, which you will get to see. And that's when my dad recognized Obi from college, because Obi had been my father's brother's college roommate. So we paused our run, thank God, I like running about as much as I like watching baseball. And we walked over to Obi and we introduced ourselves, and he began telling us about his accident and his most impressive and memorable recovery. Since talking and planning with Obi, I really have discovered the true power and capability that one has. Even though Obi has gone through more than most of an entire lifetime, he took this accident and called it an opportunity, which is just incredible. He realized that there were two ways that he could view this occurrence, and he decided to take the positive perspective, which is something that I even struggle to do with the smallest of problems. Obi, you are such an inspiration and a role model for leading a positive, strong, and generous life, and I'm so happy that you're here. I'm so happy that I get to talk to you. I think we're going to show the Inside Edition video right now.
An actor who starred in several landmark TV shows stands tall as an inspiration to others after losing his legs in a devastating accident. Jim Murray has his story.
This actor and yoga teacher, whose legs were amputated in a horrific hit-and-run crash, refuses to let anything slow him down.
I wasn't going to let, you know, amputations of my legs stop me.
Get me another one!
Obi Ndefo appeared in Star Trek Deep Space Nine and was a series regular on Dawson's Creek. At a commanding 6 feet, 4 inches tall, he was a force to be reckoned with on Stargate SG-1.
This is right where I was hit.
Obi was loading groceries into his parked car when he was struck by a suspected drunk driver.
My right leg was severed instantly, and the left had to be amputated above the knee at the hospital about half an hour later.
Footage from the scene shows his car's crumpled bumper and a pool of blood where he was standing.
It was horrible, but I in some ways I was fine.
The doctors couldn't believe it. They couldn't believe
miracle,
that you
yeah.
pulled through.
Yeah.
It was a miracle he survived. What he did next was just as incredible.
I made the decision to not do pain medication.
Here he is working out 6 weeks after losing his legs. 9 weeks after the accident, he was back to yoga. Today, he displays extraordinary strength and determination. Incredibly, he calls losing his legs an opportunity to do something more with his life.
An opportunity to keep working, to keep creating as an actor and a writer, and to find new opportunities, and to hopefully, you know, be a beacon of light to others.
How did you kind of accept the situation? How did this situation affect you?
Yeah, you know, so this happened back in August of this last year, and I was working in pre-production, writing and doing some notes on a script during that day. And then I went to also teach a yoga class, and then went to Erewhon Natural Foods Market, where I normally shop at night, and was loading. I came out of the store and was loading groceries into the back of my trunk. And wow. What can I say? What can I say? You know, life is so funny. It's, I mean, funny and so many things. I'm laughing now, but you know, it was no laughing matter at the time. But you know, every moment you never know what's going to happen. You know, and this was just one of those moments that could have been or should have been like any other. But essentially, what happened was a drunk driver came out of nowhere while I was loading groceries into my trunk and hit me square on full speed from behind, pinned me right in between his car and my bumper of my car. So the right leg was severed immediately, and the left leg had to be amputated above the knee half an hour later at the hospital. So, you know, I would be remiss in not saying, you know, it was quite a spiritual experience from the moment it happened. You know, I literally one of my first thoughts was, you know, oh, I was going to go home and write. and there's all my food on the ground. There goes my dinner. You know, the mind is so funny, Jamie. It's so fascinating, you know, and just sort of gathering what had happened, you know, I felt like I was knocked down. I was probably out for about a minute and a half or 2 minutes. And there was just so much blood loss and so much, I mean, it's something you see in a movie, right?
Yeah.
But then it's happening to you. And, you know, wonderful man, Chef Alberto Tito Lazzarino, held my hand stayed with me until the ambulance came a few minutes later and called for blankets and everything. Amazing paramedics took me to Cedars-Sinai, 2 miles away, you know, and met Dr. Milton Little, one of the best orthopedic surgeons in the world, you know, who saved my life. And, you know, I remember asking if my legs were still there. You know, I knew there was a profound thing transpiring, you know, a profound moment was happening, you know. And for somebody who lives in their body, who's an actor, you know, writer, performer, and I teach yoga and all these things, and you know, my body was my home and my temple, like for all of us, you know. So I just beg, you know, please save as much of my body as you can. You know, you never think you would have to say that. And, you know, woke up in the hospital with a new body. And the last 10 months has been quite a journey, which we'll talk about today. And we'll talk about, you know, how it influenced my awareness about spirituality, you know, my concept of survival and health, you know, and as it relates to the pandemic now and the work I was doing before and now, and you know, and anything else you want
to
know.
To ask you about was your kind of recovery process. I mean, yours, from what I've kind of learned and read in the past, you refused pain medications, which is, I mean, remarkable. Yeah. But you also, yeah, I think, had a spiritual journey. So can you tell us, yeah, kind of about that?
Well, there's a lot of layers to what I've been going through, you know, which people may be able to relate to on different levels. But the fascinating thing is that, well, two things. I kind of, you know, have devoted myself, my particular lifestyle, my survival to, you know, eating healthy and taking care of my body. You know, I've been through health challenges in the past and emotional challenges in the past and found that, you know, eating organically. I happen to be a raw vegan. That's just me. That's my choice the last 10 years. So that's how I get my sustenance and, you know, really, really practice yoga and these things. So when I was hit by the car, you know, my body did something that's kind of fascinating. And I went into a mode of reserves, as far as I can understand. And in the hospital, I did everything with holistic healing. So all natural foods, organic, raw vegan food, and breathing and yoga and meditation. I didn't do any pain medication after the day of the surgery. I mean, during the surgery, you're out. But I didn't intend to. It wasn't some principle of mine, but it was just a feeling, Jamie, that these principles that I live by about, you know, living close to nature and having faith in the plant kingdom and sort of how we've evolved, you know, and that my body can fight things naturally. And, you know, it really got put to the test, you know, and I had to do what little yoga I could with missing my legs as much as I am, you know, and I really didn't have a choice but to just say, okay, these are my principles, I'm gonna go for it. And the strange thing is that I was 5 years into development for a television series that I co-created with a wonderful rising comedic actress, Cara Deptula, called Juice Bar, which is, and we'll talk about this later, but but it relates to this story that, you know, the whole show is this wonderful, kaleidoscopic, colorful, you know, Willy Wonka meets Pee-wee's Playhouse, for all ages show that's set in a juice bar in a health center. And it's a satire of all these things that I survived by, you know. It's satire, yeah. Makes fun of organic food and spirituality and, oh yeah, you can cure, you know, you can cure cancer with kale and all these things. And, mm-hmm. and, And so it makes fun of yoga and astrology and, you know, all these things that are quote unquote alternative. But also the show is kind of like Sesame Street. It's like a warm-hearted embrace of multiculturalism and inclusivity. And it's really like a second coming, I believe, of Sesame Street. And so, Jamie, I learned so much more as a writer in writing almost the whole first season of the show about natural foods and about the power of yoga and about breathing and about all these things that sound kind of, you know, wonky and hippy dippy and that now are coming out, you know, especially in relation to the pandemic and our global search for health. You know, what is the immune system? What is what is a virus? What is the common cold? You know, what is and what are all these other pandemics that we're going through as a culture? You know, diabetes, obesity, cancer, Alzheimer's, and frankly, depression and anxiety. So in the hospital, to get back to your question, you know, I felt like I was in a test tube or a petri dish of my own, of the universe's making, and I had to survive, you know, and lo and behold, I was back in the gym 10 days after leaving the hospital as a double amputee, you know, and I made a decision, Jamie, to be super positive, and it hasn't been easy, but I use these tools to survive. So
your attitude is something that we can all aspire to, especially during this time of quarantine, while we're kind of sitting at home doing nothing. How do you think, what would you kind of recommend for people? What would you say kind of would help you through, but in this time where we're all kind of isolated, we're sick at home, we're really angsty, you've got a lot of energy that's pent up. What attitude and what energy do you think that we should kind of utilize in order to help our situation?
Right. Well, you know, great question. You know, I really feel that now is a time on planet Earth when we really want to decide what our purpose is as a planet, as a species, as humanity, you know. And you and I are both artists, you know, we're both, you know, you're a wonderful actor and dancer, singer, performer, and I have dedicated my life to the arts, you know. So what we live for, you can relate to this, is art and human expression and us using our vehicles, using our bodies to be a vehicle of expression and change and, you know, and for humanity. So, you know, I feel with all the things that are going on with health on the planet and with things like systemic racism and things that you know, everyone being treated equal, we need to sort of, you know, put our feet down or whatever limbs we got down and say what we stand for, you know, and what I believe is we need to stand for love, you know, and it's getting to the point where it's ridiculous. We got to say, you know, whoever you are, whatever your skin color, whatever your gender, whatever your, you know, socioeconomic status, you know, however much money's in your bank account, if you're gay, if you're transgender, if you're bi, if you're quote straight, if you are Republican, if you are Democrat, if you have a child who has autism, if you have fourth stage breast cancer or ovarian cancer, if you if you're someone who's suffering with depression or anxiety, like I've had to deal with intensely in long periods of my life, you are loved just the same by the universe. We are all loved just the same, you know, and this is a time when we have to go to the mountaintop and scream at the top of our lungs, we are all equal, you know, and we are all alive and we're all related, you know. So I think my advice in this time is to hold on to that, because everyone's got a specific particular situation in their own quarantine, their own life, mothers taking care of kids on their own, families, you know, with that have to, you know, struggle to get by, you know, everyone's got a struggle. We all have struggles, you know, and so I think it's really digging into that purpose and letting that be your salvation.
On that note, thank you so much. That is so amazing. We're going to watch another video. This is from the LA Times telling of Obi's story. And then after that, we're going to hear from some of our singers.
I just started repeating, I'm alive, I'm alive, I'm alive. I so clearly could have died. Something in me, I had to instantaneously accept the reality of loss. What is the best way to look at what happens? Do you know what I mean? Is it a loss? Is it a tragedy? I started to realize day by day, but that who says that this isn't an opportunity? You know, what constitutes a something good or something bad is a little bit in our mind. I'm in a new body now. Life goes on, you know, and so my yoga practice has just had to shift. You know, there's some things I can't do as well, and some things I can do even better. How does anybody get through a challenging situation? What do you hold on to? You know, is it your faith? Is it your belief in something greater than yourself? My father is Nigerian, West African. My mother is American, you know, Russian, Polish, Jewish descent. I grew up in a family that's very human and about humanity. You know, there's so many kinds of people that faith, you know, that's sort of my faith is one of several, but that's an important one for me, is just knowing that we're all connected and we can all help each other through our different, you know, experiences. Because you never know what people are going through. When people kept asking me that, you know, like, how are you doing this? I don't know how you're doing this. I could never do this. And I started to answer, like, wait a minute. You don't know. Like, how do you know what you would do, really, in a trauma situation? You know, in life, we're taken to these places that are just deeply beyond what we expect, you know, and you have to then, I guess, you know, dig so deep into a place in yourself that you don't even know that you have. And I found that in this, through this accident, and I think anyone can attest to this who's been through a life, a near-death experience, that it essentializes you so that your purpose becomes crystal clear. I don't have time for negativity, you know? It's like there are people counting on me, and I feel like I can really benefit the world from continuing to carry out my message and my art form. This is how I live my life up to now. Why would I stop now? I have to try to make the most of whatever is happening right now.
We're going to start hearing from some singers now. The first one,
great.
We're back. First one I'm going to introduce is Annalise Scarpati. Carpacci. I first met Annalise at a cabaret that we did together, and the first time I heard her sing, I was absolutely blown away. She was in the original cast of A Christmas Story on Broadway. She performed with Matilda on Broadway, and recently she opened previews for the new Broadway show, Mrs. Doubtfire, where she plays Lydia. If you haven't heard her sing What the Hell from that show, search it up right after this and listen, because that song gives me chills every time.
Hey, Obi, I'm Annalise Scarpacci, and I just wanted to tell you what an absolute inspiration you are. Just spreading some light and love to you. This song's for you.
There's a place for us somewhere, a place for us, peace and quiet. Somewhere there.
to look, time to care. Someday, somewhere, we'll find a new way of living. We'll find a way of forgiving.
Wow.
So good.
What an angelic voice. Amazing.
Yeah. No, she is so good. Next person I'm going to hear from is my dear friend Eric Jewett. Eric, a long time ago when I was spending a lot of time in New York auditioning and interviewing.
What is his name? His name is Eric?
Eric has always been extremely talented. His operatic voice landed him on Harry Connick Jr.'s talk show. Right now, he's manifesting his 18-octave vocal range at a program at Juilliard. Yes, Juilliard. So I'm going to let him take it away.
Hey, Obi, I heard about your story, and it's really inspiring, so I just wanted to do this little song for you, and I want you to keep fighting the good fight. What you've been doing and what you are doing and what you're going to do is amazing and it's great, so this is for you. His heart pouring out of his head. I wish that you could see the pain that I've seen and all of the time spent being not me. And I hope that you know it's not always happy in my head. But I don't know the perfect road to go down, but I know I'm trying my best to be okay. I'm trying my best, but every day it's so hard. And I'm holding my breath till I can say all of the words I wanna say from my heart. Got nothing left to hide. Would you believe me if I told you that I've got flaws? Now it's time to let the curtains unfold and tell all the stories that I didn't want told. Yeah, let it out so I unburden my soul. I won't stop, 'cause I thank you. trying my best to be okay. I'm trying my best, but every day it's so hard. And I'm holding my breath. I'm holding my breath till I can say all of the words I want to say from my heart.
I'm going to start crying. These are so amazing.
incredible. These are really amazing. The next performer I'm going to introduce is Josie Todd. I met Josie last year when we started rehearsals for Because of Winn-Dixie at the Goodspeed Opera House. Since that show, she's been a really dear friend of mine. She's so talented and just the absolute sweetest girl on earth. She also has a special message. So without further ado, this is Josie Todd.
Josie Todd.
Hi, Obi. This is Josie Todd, all the way from Tennessee. I'm so happy to be sharing this song with you because you're such a role model for people who support inclusion and diversity. And that's super important to me because my brother was born with an intellectual and developmental disability. So I'm so honored to be a part of this fundraiser for you. So this one's for you, Obi.
That was incredible.
Everything's a little frozen. Don't worry. If you could say, Josie was amazing, as always. Thank you so much. Really quickly, before we get into the next singer, Obi, I just wanted to ask you about You said we were teaching yoga to special needs kids before this happened, even quite quickly after.
Yeah. I got into yoga, for my own health and my own sanity. You know, it really saved my life in difficult periods of my life. It helped me with, coping with emotional challenges. And, and when I got deeper and deeper to yoga and decided I wanted to be a teacher, along with, as a compliment to being an actor and a writer, it just got deeper and deeper, and I found that working with people of all abilities was really essential, especially people with injuries and working with kids with special needs, I got really drawn to, because I think the kids I work with who are in a huge, huge range of just emotional sensitivity, things you might categorize as autism or Asperger's, ADHD, different sort of wonderful emotional flowers, emotional beings. And I found that yoga was a really great access point to help the most sensitive human beings really get in their bodies and feel comfortable, and I'm convinced at this point we're all special needs, we all have we all have just sensitivities that are unique to us.
No, that is just so incredible. I just kind of wanted to touch on that before we got into the next performances, because I think that is so incredible and awesome to do something like that just to help those people. But the next singer that I'm going to introduce is Roz Ryan, who I worked with at the Good Speed Opera House as well, and she's just such a joy to be around. She has been in numerous shows, including Chicago on Broadway, Casey Undercover, starring Zendaya. Also, just putting it out there, probably the coolest credit on her resume is that she voiced one of the five muses in Hercules, the Disney animated movie. And here's my rendition of her line, probably the most iconic line. What do you mean, funky beats? I asked Roz to send something fun and amazing to record this with her grandkids, and it is just too sweet. So here she is.
Hi, Obi. This is Max. And we just came to give you some cheer and some love. And Jamie called and told me about your situation. And I just want you to know, baby, that we're thinking about you. We're praying for you. And we just want to make you smile, okay? Here we go. Just what makes that little ant think he can move that rubber tree plant? Everyone knows an ant can't. What key am I in? Jesus. Okay, don't cut. I can do it again. Obi. Okay, here we go. Just what makes that little ant think he can move that rubber tree plant? Everyone knows an ant can't move a rubber tree plant, but he's got
high hopes.
He's got
high hopes.
He's got high apple pie in the sky. So every time you're feeling low, just to think about, just remember that ant. Oops, there goes another rubber tree. Oops, there goes another rubber tree. Oops, there goes another rubber tree plant by the ant. He moved the plant. Chaka Khan. Bye, Obi.
Thank you so much, Roz. Oh my gosh, she's so sweet.
That was phenomenal. Oh my god.
Yeah, she's the best. Thank you so much, Roz. The next performer I'm going to be introducing is Chloe Cheers. Chloe is the final three of the people that performed with me at Pittsburgh Opera. We grew quite close during the 12 weeks in East Haddam. She brought down the house every single night she performed. She's so great and amazing. Anyway, she just finished her freshman year at the esteemed LaGuardia Performing Arts High School in New York. She is so talented and so much fun to be around. And tonight, he is going to be performing Amazing Grace.
Hi, Obi. When I heard your story and what you went through, I really, really wanted to help out in some way. You are awe-inspiring and powerful, and you're living proof that we can achieve anything with love and grace. So this is for you. Ooh, amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved us.
These people that you know, Jamie, are just amazing.
They're really great.
Oh, my God.
They're so good. Great. Anyway, so for those of you watching, this is Jenny. Jenny is an actress. You went to Yale undergraduate with Obi, right?
Yes, I did.
That is so cool. That is so fun. Jenny, she told me earlier she's actually the head of undergraduate acting at Tulane, which is so cool. I don't know. Jenny is actually my aunt's sister. So we've known each other since I was basically born, and we see each other Thanksgiving every year. So that's really fun. But anyway, tell the viewers about yourself.
Yeah. So I'm super lucky that I have known Obi. I'm going to date myself here now for over 25 years. And we were in college together. As Jamie was saying, his father... There's an echo here. I'm not sure what's up with that. Do you hear that, Jamie?
I don't hear one.
Okay, I hear an echo, but hopefully no one else does. Jamie's uncle Don and Obi were roommates at Yale, and Obi and I were both really active in the a cappella singing community as well as in the theater undergraduate community, and. I just wanted to share a few words. I just sent a quick text to some of my best friends from college asking them to describe Obi at Yale. And here's what came in. Handsome, kind, talented, shiny, McDreamy, super talented. He never made you feel less than or small, even though he was such a star. And I think that's the perfect thing to know about Obi. Even before this accident, Obi has always been such a beacon of light. Such a beautiful, beautiful man inside and out. All of us had crushes on Obi. I think every person at Yale had a crush on Obi, regardless of gender. And yet he handled the attention with such grace, and he was so open-hearted and so generous to me, especially as I started to become an actor. Obi's always been a mentor to me and a role model. And so everyone at Yale, I was so happy when this accident happened. I wasn't happy that the accident happened, but it was wonderful to see the outpouring of support from the Yale community. And Obi continues to inspire us all, just like he did in the 90s at Yale. He continues to inspire us all today.
Yeah, no, that is so awesome. Sorry, I was muted everything. Yeah, no, he. I can imagine. I wish I was one of the attended Yale with him. He's such an awesome guy. Anyway, you have some kind of. We have some songs that you helped find and organize, which is so incredible. So we're gonna play the next song. Hopefully Obi can get in soon enough, as soon as possible. He's unfortunately AWOL for now. But I think that we can go ahead and play. Why don't we play Mom? Why don't we play? Sorry, my mom's behind the scenes. My mom is my stage manager for this escapade. So that may be the reason for some of these technical difficulties, because she's not technical guru.
Do not throw your mother under the bus, so, Jamie.
Why don't we play, Jenny? You sent in a group, a video with your group singing.
Yeah, so I was part of a group at Yale called Something Extra. Yeah, and Something Extra was Yale's premier all-female a cappella singing group. And so what we like to call ourselves. And my group, I was there at Yale from 1991 to 1995, overlapping with Obi for 3 years. And Obi was a part of a group called the Baker's Dozen. And Something Extra and the BDs often had concerts together. And as I say, back then, we were all huge fans of Obi, and we still are today. So a couple of months ago, before COVID, we had a mini reunion, and we all decided to sing our traditional closing song called The New Jerusalem and send it to Obi as an inspirational message, telling him how much we loved him and hoping that he would continue to improve with such amazing speed and inspire us all. So I did not tell my fellow sisters in Something Extra that I was going to broadcast this recording on the World Wide Web. So this is a surprise for all of them too. But I think we sound pretty darn good for no rehearsal after 25 years. So judge us kindly, world. We did it for Obi.
No judgment.
How
did those feet in ancient time walk upon England's mountain green? And was the holy Lamb of God on England's pleasant pasture seen? And did the countenance divine shine forth upon our clouded hills? And was Jerusalem builded here among these dark satanic mills? Bring me my bow of burning gold. Bring me my arrows of desire. Bring me my spear, O clouds unfold. Bring me my chariot of fire. I will not cease from mental fight, nor shall my sword sleep in my hand, till we have built Jerusalem in England's green and pleasant land.
Love you, Obi.
Love you, Obi.
Mitchell? Let's see.
Hopefully, Obi's on. I don't know if you can see him. We're trying to get him. But he might be black screen right now. Obi, can you hear us?
I can hear you perfectly.
Okay.
Hi, Obi.
Hi, Jay.
Yeah, as long as you can talk.
I heard everything you said. I'm just so moved. It's so wonderful to see your face, and it's just so touching and so moving, and it's I'm thrilled. Thank you.
I'll introduce Ian. Ian is another one of Ian was Ian Mitchell is his name. He was also at Yale with Obi and I, and an incredibly talented performer and someone who loves Obi with all his heart and was really grateful to be able to participate.
Obi, hey man, I just want to let you know that I'm thinking about you. I wanted to thank you for being the inspiration that you are with your strength and your resilience. It's amazing. And I know I'm not alone in that by any means. So thank you.
Let the words from my mouth bring you praise. Let each word that I speak be seen. Choose to say, bring glory, not shame, to your name each day. Let the words from my mouth bring you praise. Let them bring you praise.
That was so
God.
Cool.
Wow.
I'm freaking out. That was so amazing.
Gosh. That's like chills. Chills up and down my spine. Oh my God.
Yeah. So, Obi, this is a special surprise for you and for all of your fans, new and old, who are watching today. If you're not happy that we're showing this, you can blame me. And a little hint, Eric Strachan, who, among many others, sends their love. But you all heard me describe Obi in college 25 years ago and how incredibly handsome and radiant and beautiful he was then as he is now. And now you all have a chance to see that he has been a superstar for a long time.
Some of those people in the dog pound were those people you met yesterday?
Yeah, this is my homeboy at the Baker's Dozen from Yale University. You know, they can
you don't know nobody from Yale.
Exactly. You didn't know I went to Yale. Why not?
See, you met them where?
I met them at the mall the other day.
Yeah, Tamika's working on her own little show, and she was out doing remotes, you know. And it's now Yale, the college.
I told
okay.
you I went, man.
Okay, I mean, I just want to make sure it went locksmiths or something like that.
Yeah,
like Yale. Wait, stand up. The guys from Yale, stand up.
Yeah, y'all stand up.
Oh, yeah. No, okay. They're what now?
They're the Baker's Dozen. They sing.
Oh. Okay.
Why don't y'all sing a little something for the people out here?
It's my show, Tamika. You're working on one somewhere
else. You know? Yeah, y'all get busy and sing, you know?
Okay, she wants y'all to sing, and she's in charge. Could you do something, anything? And Sandy, then we'll go to commercial after they finish singing, If It's All Right with Tamika. Your hair looks good.
Thank you.
Yeah,
baby.
Get a beat, boy. My soul, I wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Oh, give me the beat, boys, to free my soul. I wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. If my mind is bringing you something, and I'm feeling low.
Bookdahl, the current biz of the BDs and son of Jacob Bookdahl 94. We want to dedicate you this song, Drift Away. iPhone quality is a little suspect, so maybe our visual blends off a little bit, maybe our regular blends off a little bit, but we hope you enjoy.
Day after day I'm more confused, but I look through the light in the pouring rain, yeah. Know that's a game that I hate to lose. I'm feeling the strain. Ain't it a shame? Oh, give me the beat, boys, and free my soul. Wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Give me the beat, boys, and free my soul. I wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Beginning to think that I'm wasting time. I don't understand the things that I do know. The world outside seems so unkind. But I'm counting on you to carry me through. Give me the beat, boys, free my soul. Wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Give me the beat, boys, free my soul. Wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. And when my mind is free, you know the melody can move me. When I'm feeling low, the guitar's coming through to soothe me. Ooh, thanks for the joy you bring in me. I want you to know I believe in your song. The rhythm and rhyme and harmony. Helps me along. You making me strong. Yeah, you making me strong.
Give it to me.
Give me the beat, boys. Whoa, 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 whoa. Give me the beat, boys. I want you free my soul. Whoa, and drift away. To be now. Oh, why don't you free my soul? Yeah, yeah, and drift away. Give me the beat, boys, free my soul. Wanna get lost in your rock and roll and drift away. Why don't you free my soul?
That is so cool. I cannot believe. That is awesome. Oh my gosh. And Obi is like so talented. I don't know what happened. We're still dealing with technical difficulties trying to get him back.
Oh, yeah, I want to hear his reaction. Obi, can we hear you or no?
I don't know if he's on. He's not on at the moment, unfortunately. But we still have hopefully he'll be on back in a second. We still have many more performances to see, but gosh, that is so cool. Jenny, tell us what else kind of, how it is, now that, since Obi's not here, I'm personally wondering, what is kind of that a cappella scene like at Yale? I mean, I know it's, I've had friends that go that do that, and it's so awesome.
Yeah, I mean, I think for plenty of people, it can be sort of a source of annoyance, but for those of us who are in it, who were in it and part of it, it's truly one of the most wonderful parts was the most wonderful part of my college experience. You know, wonderful friendships that persist to this day. And for me, it was the gateway to theater and acting. And I think for Obi, he was always doing both. He was singing a cappella and he was doing theater. And then of course went right on to Yale School of Drama, which is highly unusual for someone to get accepted into Yale School of Drama right out of undergrad, which is just a testament to how talented Obi has always been. Mm-hmm. It's wonderful friendships. And, you know, it's as is evidenced by Ian's performance tonight. And the fact that, you know, Eric Strachan dug through boxes in his attic to find the VHS tape that we miraculously got digitized. It's a really strong community and a supportive community and one that stands behind Obi 100%. And we are all in awe of his recovery. Are you there? Is he coming back?
Yeah, I think that's him. I don't know if he can probably hear us. I don't know if he can see us. Oh, he's gone again. Whatever. One thing I did want to talk about, because I think that's so awesome, it's just kind of, I'm at high school, we have this group called the Orphans, and we kind of do the same thing, kind of get a taste, and yeah, it is true, kind of friendships form around something so interesting as music, and I think the fact that me, you, and Obi kind of get to experience that in our lives and that we're all surrounded by it. I think that that, especially for me, is so, I mean, music has always been kind of really important to me, even when I was a kid, kind of subconsciously. I didn't realize how important it would become, but.
Well, no pressure, Jamie, but you know, everyone in our family is hoping that you'll continue the a cappella tradition and following my
steps. Oh my gosh, yes, no, I think it's, yeah, no, I mean, especially in the group that I do at school, it's so special to kind of get to do that. And especially because, I mean, even though sometimes people have solos, usually it doesn't matter because it's not even about that. It's about kind of working as a unit and helping anybody that's having a hard time. And I think that that almost translates into nowadays. Like, even though Obi is just the most incredibly independent and strong-willed person I've really ever had the experience of meeting, I think that the fact that we kind of get to do this to help him out, especially with his GoFundMe, I think that that is so special and so important. So I'm actually going to take this time to remind anybody who's watching right now, if you haven't yet, please donate to Obi's GoFundMe. He's trying to get a new pair of prosthetic legs and kind of pay off the last of the medical bills that have piled up because, unfortunately, insurance can't cover everything. But please, if you haven't yet, donate. That's kind of what this cause is for, and I don't know if I've really stressed that enough. If you're watching right now, please donate. And even for those who are watching, if you are watching, get the message out. Tell people to donate as much as they can. This is really important to me and really important, I'm sure, to anybody watching. Obi, I think, is back. I think he's in the studio right now. Wait. Yes, finally. Well, okay, great.
Oh, my gosh.
Is there Arsenio Hall footage?
Oh, that's amazing. That just brought back so many memories.
Yeah, oh, I'm my happy goodness. You liked
so,
it.
So one of the
biggest. Right after. I don't know what happened behind.
Because I've been gone for a while. I just wanted to thank Jenny, Jenny Mercine, for coming on. And she's just a wonderfully talented, kind-hearted, beautiful, amazing human being. Just really, oh my God, makes my day, my week, my year, and everything. And Ian Mitchell, I mean, speaks for himself, sings for himself. I mean, stunning. What a talent! What a talent! And what a creative, sensitive, powerful human being. And I thank everyone that's being involved. And anyway, so yeah, so we've got some more people coming up.
Next, we have a message from Michael Lee Brown, who was in Dear Evan Hansen on Broadway. He just wanted to give a little message.
Hey, my name is Michael Lee Brown from Broadway's Dear Evan Hansen. I just want to say thank you so much to Obi for being such an inspiration and light to myself and so many others.
Thank you so much, Michael. That was so sweet.
Thanks, Michael.
Hey, Michael was actually, he played all three roles. So he played the three main roles. He played Evan. And then he played two other roles in the production, which is really incredible. Next, we have a performance from Joey and Griffin McIntyre, who I met Griffin when we started filming for Country Comfort. He is the funniest, coolest, kindest, and most handsome. If there are any other seventh graders on this live stream, I'm telling you, that kid's going to be the heartthrob of your generation. He is the best screen brother I could have asked for, and his dad Joe is actually one of the five members of the New Kids on the Block. So without further ado, here and Joey.
Hello, Obi. It is Griffin McIntyre.
And I'm Joe McIntyre, Griffin's dad. And we have both been inspired by your story like so many people. It's just amazing what you've been through and how much of a light you are and an example of just going for it and continuing with life, no matter what it brings you. So thank you for doing what you do. And we just got news of this fundraiser. We want to thank Jamie for asking us to be a part of it. You know, we're halfway there.
We are.
We're
halfway there.
Yeah.
And everyone sounds good in the shower.
And everyone sounds good in the shower. That's her in the shower. Very good. Do you know the key that we're starting? Is everyone going to sing in the shower?
Yeah.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, we're halfway there.
Oh, living on a prayer.
Take my hand.
We'll make it, I swear.
Oh, living on a prayer. Living on a prayer.
Obi. Rock bye. On.
Yay, oh my gosh, thank you guys so much. That was so awesome. That was so nice.
Epic belting in the shower. I love it.
Epic belting in the shower. Totally relatable. I guess I'm actually up next to sing, which is fun, I guess. I'm gonna have to plug my ears. I don't compare to any of the other people, but shameless plug, I'm just gonna take some time. Shameless plug, watch Country Comfort on Netflix when it comes out. And then I'm just going to take some time to tell you all to donate again, because I think that's important. Donate now, if you haven't already.
Your show on Netflix is called what? Country Comfort, right? Country Comfort. New show on Netflix.
Country Comfort on Netflix.
Great.
It'll come out eventually if coronavirus ends.
This is for you, Obi.
Another turning point, a fork stuck in the road. Time grabs you by the wrist, directs you where to go. So make the best of this test and don't ask why. It's not a question, but a lesson learned in time. It's something unpredictable, but in the end it's right. I hope you had the time of your life. So take the photographs in still frames in your mind. Hang it on a shelf in good health and good time. Tattoos of memories and dead skin on trial. For what it's worth, it was worth it all the while. It's something unpredictable, but in the end it's right. I hope you had the time of your life. La da 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 da. La da 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 da. It's something unpredictable, but in the end it's right. I hope you had the time of your life.
Thank you.
What an amazing voice. What an amazing spirit you are, man.
Thank you, Obi. That's sweet.
Have you always sung since you were tiny?
Well, I think I started singing a little later. I started kind of singing lessons at the age of 7, like second grade. So I've just been kind of singing since then. I was singing all my life, but like singing.
But you love doing it, clearly.
I do like it. It's very fun. I love doing things for a good cause.
Yeah.
But now that that's over and done with, I'm going to hog the screen once more. But I'm going to be joined by my brother and sister, Cameron and Talia. Cameron was filming an HBO miniseries called Merrick Easttown with Kate Winslet. And Talia will be heading out to San Francisco in the next week to start filming a movie. So this is the Mann Clan.
The Mann Clan loves you, Obi.
Why do you build me up, buttercup baby, just to let me down, and mess me around, and then worst of all, you never call baby like you say you will. I love you still, I need you, more than anyone's. don't break my heart.
That was fun. We had a fun time filming that.
That's amazing.
It's
so incredible.
We have fun. We have fun performing. We barely do it because we don't. But anyway. The next performer is Lily Brooks. I just met Lily Brooks quite recently in LA while I was filming, and she's just the sweetest. Her new show, The Big Show, just came out on Netflix, so go watch that if you haven't. She was a triple threat, also appearing, who also appeared as Matilda in the national tour. Here she is, Lily Brooks.
Lily Brooks, amazing.
Hi, everyone. My name is Lily Brooks O'Brien. I play Mandy White on Netflix's The Big Show. I am so honored to be a part of this amazing event. Obi, you are such an inspiration, and I'm super excited to be able to sing this song for you.
We're broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round. And you can't find a fighter, but I see it in you, so we gon' walk it out and move mountains. We gon' walk it out and move mountains. And I'll rise like the day, I'll rise unafraid, I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. And I'll rise up, high like the waves, I'll rise up, in spite of the ache, I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you, for you, for you, when the silence isn't quiet and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe. You know you feel like dying, but I promise we would take the world to its feet and move mountains, bring it to its feet and move mountains. And I'll rise like the day, I'll rise up. In spite of the ache, I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. And I'll rise up, high like the waves, I'll rise up. In spite of the ache, I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you. For you, for you, all we need is hope, and for that we have each other, and for that we have each other. We will rise, we will rise, we will rise. Oh, 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 we'll rise. I'll rise up, I'll rise like the day, I'll rise up. In spite of the ache, I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. And I'll rise up, high like the waves, I'll rise up. In spite of the ache, I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you. For you.
She's so sweet. She's so good. Thank you so much, Olivia. Wow.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. This is life changing for me, I really have to say. Just hearing these young people of all ages, I think we really need, I have mixed feelings about, I've always had mixed feelings about when being focused on, I don't know how you feel as a performer being one where the spotlight is on you for whatever reason, if it's a fundraiser or something, you're the subject, but, I just think objectively, so there's my feelings about that, but there's also objectively, I think this is a time when we really need positivity in general, whether it's about this person or that person. Totally. These are times when we're focusing on certain, for example, segments of the population that have been marginalized and abused, that gets the spotlight, I think in general, we need this kind of discussion about, positivity and how to uplift each other. So this is very touching. Thank you very much.
Of course. Yeah, no, I totally agree. I think the next thing that we're going to show is the Lightworkers video, which is, again, totally ties into that kind of aspect of positivity and just, making the world a better place.
Great.
The Lightworkers video.
Beautiful. Using this instrument that is still alive, my heart's still beating, blood's still pumping, so I can use that to tell stories. I just didn't think I would have to tell my story. But here we go. I think between the time when I was hit and I was on my back, one of the first things I said was I hit by a car. And one of the things I said subsequently was, are my legs still there? Faster I could accept this as something I could do absolutely nothing about, the healthier I would be and the better off I would be. I think as an actor, I'm used to having to take on a different role, to sort of to step into somebody else's shoes. Anybody that I meet, I try to have compassion for. So I was able to, I think, apply that compassion to myself and not beat myself up or not focus on anger at the driver. My shortest path to healing again was just inhabiting this new role. Clearly feels like there's something, some greater hand at work here that's moving some of these chess pieces that I'm only semi-aware of what's going on. I do feel that I didn't die for a reason, that I hung on and I'm still here and I'm fighting because I have a message, I have a mission, I have a purpose. I'm stronger than I thought I was, much, much stronger than I thought I was, because I had to be.
I wanted to ask you I wanted to talk about your new show, Juice Bar. I think that that's something really important to you, and I just kind of wanted you to just kind of set the stage, not just also what the show's about, and then also kind of the process that it's in right now, kind of in development due to coronavirus.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, 6 years ago, a wonderful young rising comedic actress, Cara Deptula, and I started development of her show called Juice Bar. And, I grew up watching, being really hooked on Sesame Street and Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood.
Yeah.
Remember those shows, Jamie?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, many generations, right? And there was a wonderful children's album created by the wonderful Marlo Thomas and friends called Free to Be You and Me, which included a lot of amazing people like Mel Brooks and Harry Belafonte and Michael Jackson. Mm-hmm. Just amazing, amazing people. And it was all about, you know, accepting who you are. And there was a, you know, the title theme song, Free to Be You and Me. And I just remember that kind of experience on television and what Fred Rogers did, you know, really giving an expression of care, which is a very rare thing, you know, for somebody who works in film and television and media, you know, to grow up with that, you know, there was this hole in the pit of my being. And as an actor, you know, after graduating from the Yale School of Drama and being thrust into television and, you know, loving the work, I found myself really needing to be connected to something that I could believe in, you know. And so we developed this show, which, you know, was just a wonderful, wonderful odyssey that started 6 years ago. And we were saying, you know, that there needs to be a show. Remember the show Cheers? Do you ever remember the show
called? Yeah, Cheers? I did start watching Cheers. I think it just
came out. Created by the wonderful James Burroughs, you know, which is a place where everyone knows your name.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
yes.
You know, I'm one of these people that, you know, in terms of the survival of the accident, you know, we talk about, you know, organic food and health and yoga and all these things I live my life by. So I'm definitely like a foodie, and I love organic food, and I love yoga and all these things, but there's a whole ridiculous side to it, right? You know, there's you know, just kind of people that are so involved in everything that's quote unquote alternative, you know?
Uh-huh.
It's like, I've got to have my goji berry smoothie, and, you know, because my chakras are all out of alignment, you know, and oh my gosh, you know, like the universe is falling apart, and I need to, you know, I need to, meditate and go to a mountaintop and go to India, go into an ashram. You know, it's like all these.
We foster like this kind of trend.
Yeah.
Center,
so we created this
media, kind of this idea one, that you can these trends just come and go so fast, and they're very
the trends come and go so fast. So we created this show that's called Juice Bar. That's set in you know, this epic sprawling Juice Bar and Health Center that's like this epic airport of a Willy Wonka, kind of like Wizard of Oz meets Tim Burton movie, colorful. Yeah. It's like a children's show, right?
Yeah.
And it's about the staff that works there and all the people that come in, you know, for the various ailments. And ironically, the show deals humorously with all these pandemics. You know, it's a very funny show. Yeah. But the underbelly of the show deals with all these pandemics like depression and anxiety and diabetes and obesity. And the show goes way into cancer, into seasons 1, 2, 3, and 4, and talks about the immune system and all these things that were pre-COVID era, you know? Yeah. And, you know, we talk about it from the macro lens of our species needing to reconnect with nature, right? Needing to reconnect with animals and plants and in terms of respect for the environment and respect for ourselves and the quality of our water and our agriculture systems and the food we eat, you know. And I grew up, like a lot of us, addicted to sugar. And I would go to the market and get whole meals of, you know, gummy bears and Snickers bars and potato chips and Slurpees. And, you know, that was an experience when I was young, but that impacted me for about 20 years of my life.
Yeah.
You know, and it gave me a lot of emotional challenges that I'm still dealing with.
Yeah. No, I can imagine.
You know, and so the show is this wonderfully hysterical, satirical, whimsical, farcical show that's got a lot of physical slapstick humor, but very very intelligent, you know, about our species' search for health, You know, so we went through, we started reaching out to the distributors about this show, mm-hmm. Starting about 3-4 years ago. And the reaction was, this is incredible. This is an amazing show.
Yeah.
It's so interesting and so quirky. And what we were saying is, we have a feeling this show is going to be very important and very impactful for the planet. You know, a show all about our search for help.
Mm-hmm.
And lo and behold, we find ourselves.
Yeah, look where we are right now.
Look where we are.
Yeah.
Look where we are, you know, and sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, no, I was just going to say, once you're done, we have a video kind of you working on the pilot that we wanted to show, but yeah.
So we'll show that video and, you know, and the show deals a lot with how to get healthy and the scramble to find that, you know, but also the show very much deals with multiculturalism, you know, in a time when there is a lot of division and confusion and reconciliation of the past.
Yeah.
We need this simultaneous, you know, double-edged approach to addressing, redressing the crimes of the past and also how to move forward and come together in a multicultural coexistence way. And this show is all about everyone that comes into the bar is doesn't matter, again, the color of your skin, you know, the shape of your body, your ability, you know, whatever, you're gay, straight, whatever it is, you're welcome in this bar. And the humor is about how we're all a little bit crazy. So,
and one thing I just wanted to point out, you wrote in a double amputee when you were working on the script, right?
Yeah, I mean, the crazy thing is that we wrote, you know, I wrote a character in episode 9. It's a scripted show, 35 minute streaming show that is a double amputee or
paraplegic
that comes in and does yoga. And I was literally interviewing, other able body.
Yeah.
Actors and non-actors to play the role.
Just
what a twist of fate that this accident occurred outside one of the juice bars where this was the genesis and the inspiration for, you know. So, you know, before we show the video, I want to say to you as someone who's an artist, you know, people are saying, why are you so positive? You know, why is there a smile on your face when you went through this, you know, this experience, you know, and this tragedy, you know, and a lot of what was going through my mind in the hospital when I was hooked up to the IVs and I saw that a lot of my legs weren't there was, I have to get back to work.
Yeah.
Right. I have to get back as an artist. I really believe in the show. I believe in Juice Bar and I feel like we're here on a mission to uplift the planet with the arts.
Of course.
And this, you know, so that's a lot of my healing was, you know, I got to get back into the gym and back behind the writing and get back into pre-production, you know, because we were really far into pre-production and very close to getting it on the air. So now that this has happened, you know, and it's a few months later, there's even more of a fire in my belly and our team to get the show on the air, because I think we need this sort of revamp of Sesame Street, so to speak, talking all about health and pandemics and multiculturalism and racism, but in a fun, creative, educational, supportive, comedic environment. It's a powerful, powerful Trojan horse of a show. So this really, yes, it's the organic food and the yoga and the meditation and my mindset and the positivity, but is I needed to get back to this. You can watch some of our camera blocking rehearsals and we'll talk
more
about
it. Here they are.
So this is the Leaf Lounge where people, they read all the New Age books, they lounge, they sit. And okay, so this is the bulk bins. This is the homage to like Willy Wonka, right? So we have floor to ceiling. Carol's gonna help us build this, kind of like a steampunk inner working of bulk bins. So when you go to, so opening scene at the Blueberry Bar is Violet, right? Violet's character talking to the plant. So it's that two-page quick opening. So it's very tight, tight shots on them at the bar. But we get the gist of the background. Second scene, we go right here. This is all before the credits. Is opening shot here is, and we can go through this again and actually do it with the camera to see what the space looks like. It helps me. But it's up angle right here, kind of wide angle here. And we have two girls. We have Layla, 8-year-old African-American girl, and we just met last night.
Yeah.
And Taylor, 12-year-old, 13-year-old
Caucasian girl. It's everything is multicultural. So the opening is they go, they're facing this way, and they go, whoa. And the other one goes, whoa. And then,
Yeah.
So, but we don't see the bulkheads, we just see the faces, right? And then the Layla, the little black girl, leans in and she reads, and it says organic, fair, it's every, she's reading one, organic fair trade Indonesian cashews. They're like, whoa. And then she pulls the lever and then it's like, we hear, and their faces light up from the light cast from the bulk bins, and two little cashews go into their fingers and they try it and they're like, wow. And then the Lawrence comes in, the girl's grandfather, the white girl's grandfather, and she's like, Grandpa, this place is amazing. And then we pull back and he steps in and he goes, whoa. So they're all going, whoa. And then we flip and reverse it. This starts the Steadicam shot. Steadicam shot is we see them and then we go like this. We pull back, we step away, we pull up. So we see this like Oompa Loompa, Willy Wonka, steampunk of every organic seed, nut, and grain imaginable going all the way up. In interlocking with all this stuff here, you know, we do it easy so it's not a stress on the place. But so we go up and then their column lights up like fuchsia or green or something, like the cashews, and it spirals all the way up. And we take that in, we step back, we track up here, we see a worker there, because this is like the beehive. We're seeing like all the inner workings of who works there, and this is all the characters we're developing and all the people that come in. Okay?
That is so incredible and awesome to see.
Yeah, it's a really wonderful world we're creating, and we're working with these amazing set designers, Carol Newman from the Yale School of Drama and Val Salatino from Nature Works in Escondido, California, that are building this sort of elaborate sort of post-Avatar juice bar and health center. You know, it's a really wonderful, wonderfully epic show. So it's that was some of the set design rehearsals and camera blocking.
That is so awesome. Okay, so we got some more singers to introduce. People singing are Violet and Clara Young, who are an absolutely iconic duo who I met a long time ago through the incredible tapper, my tap teacher, Tommy Redder, and singing teachers Badeen and Trapper, who both helped out a lot tonight. And ever since I met them, they've been the sweetest, most talented, kind people in the world. Carla, their mom, and my mom are like bonded as self-proclaimed stage wives, so that's great. Violet was featured in Genius Picasso, which was by National Geographic, a show about Picasso, and Clara played Annie at the Multitude of Theater, where I then played Billy Elliot with Violet playing Debbie. These two are the most incredible all-around performers and people, and when they sing together, it is beyond compare.
Hey, Obi, I'm Violet. I'm Clara, and thank you so much for sharing your story with us. You're such an inspiration to so many people, and we put this song together for you. If you ever find yourself stuck in the middle of the sea, I'll sail the world to find you. And if you ever find yourself lost in the dark and you can't see, I'll be the light to guide you. Find out what we're made of when we are called to help our friends in need. You can count on me, like 1, 2, 3, I'll be there. And I know when I need it, I can count on you, like 4, 3, 2, you'll be there. Cause that's what friends are supposed to do, oh yeah. Ooh, ooh, yeah. If you toss it and you turn it and you just can't fall asleep, I'll sing a song beside you. And if you ever forget just how much you mean to me, every day
you can count on me. Like one, two, three, I'll be there. And I know when I need it, I can count on you. Like four, three, two, you'll be there. Cause that's what friends are supposed to do, oh yeah. Ooh.
Magical.
Yeah.
It's so funny because there's a theme song for Juice Bar that is that's very similar to that in spirit, you know.
Yeah.
Because that's a lot, you know, in talking about the show, that's a lot of what the show is about, is, you know, counting on each other and wanting to believe in a place where we can all coexist with each other, you know. It It doesn't matter, you know. And I wanted to you know, with everything you've done today, you know, and ended up talking about the show and my work and what our team is doing, you know, with Juice Bar, and the reason I'm devoting myself to all this, you know, one of the most important things to me is, you know, is getting the word out there, you know. So something what we're trying to do is to get a strong chorus of voices to get the show picked up. I think it's really important, and to urge Netflix to pick up the show, and also Apple, Amazon, and the new HBO Max platform. That's what we're calling on, is the whole entertainment community to come together, kind of like a We Are the World moment that occurred within music, with Quincy Jones and Harry Belafonte and Lionel Richie and Michael Jackson and all these folks. Yeah. When we wanted a show that was all nationalities, all music artists and film and TV artists to come together, you know. So we really need support from the entertainment community to really encourage Netflix to pick up the show if it ends up on Netflix or HBO and SKTV. So, you know, you can talk to Jamie and talk to me about it. And,
yeah.
I think it's really important that we get it on the air.
Yes. No, I totally agree. Yeah. So if you heard that, definitely keep an eye out for Juice Bar. And if you do hear about it, promote it. The last couple singers that we're going to show for you are some of Obi, some of your friends. So
yeah,
first one we have lined up is Gary. Can you kind of introduce him?
Yeah. Gary Younes is a phenomenal singer from France, an amazing musical soul, amazing human being. Great friend of a friend of Miss Sophie Binier, who is in part of the Dream Big television series that our Arts Alliance for Humanity nonprofit is also working on, and he's gonna sing a song. And do you want me to introduce him, and then we're gonna come back on to introduce the other two?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is Gary, phenomenal vocal talent.
Down, I will uplift you.
Oh, that is so good.
Isn't that stunning? Isn't that stunning?
It's so good. He's such a beautiful voice, and gosh, I wish I could play the piano. I need to start learning.
So much soul.
Yeah. I think Gina's next, so can you introduce her?
Yeah, so Gina is my cousin.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, Gina is my cousin. And Gina is phenomenal person. I don't even know where to begin. One of my favorite people on the planet. She's my cousin, Gina Belafonte, and she is an amazing actress, director, producer, and social activist. And she's been working for years. She's in a phenomenal nonprofit called Sankofa, and really works for equality of all kinds, of all peoples, and works through the arts and through protests, all ends of, you know, and definitely some similarities to her father, the amazing legendary calypso singer Harry Belafonte, and she's a great singer too, beautiful voice. And so she's here singing A Change Gonna Come, and Gina's also working on the Juice Bar project. She's amazing. On the producing team. And I just feel honored that she's my cousin and my friend and confidant, and during this whole pandemic, her husband Scott, so her partner Scott. Okay, so she's singing Change Gonna Come.
Great.
This is for you, Obi. I love you. Like the river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh yes it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know the change gonna come. Oh yes it will. I go to the movies and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me, hey, don't you hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh yes it will. Then I go to my brother and I'll say, brother, can you help me please? But he winds up knocking me down, right down, back down, back down. Times when I thought I couldn't last for long, but now I think I'm able to carry on. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh, yes. yes, it will. Change gon' come, brother.
Oh, that is so beautiful.
So I heard that. When I heard that the other day, and it's like,
yeah,
you know, when you hear something, you know, this is the thing about music and the arts. You know, it's like you really feel like you are a changed person after hearing something like that. Amazing.
Yeah. No, it's so true.
She's a phenomenal woman. She's a phenomenal human being.
She's so, yeah, a beautiful singer too.
Yeah.
Last performer of the night, Mariah.
Mariah Grande. Yeah. Mariah Grande is oh my God, an amazing gal. She, I know her from college. We were in Into the Woods together, Sondheim.
Oh my gosh.
And, she is really funny. I just remember her sense of humor and just rolling with laughter when she would say anything. Just amazingly funny and caring and really smart, savvy, just like really quick wit, and an amazing performer in on the East Coast and in the New York theater scene and all over. And she's just, you know, really committed artist. And and we haven't stayed so much directly in touch since college, but I've been aware of her and aware of her performing. And I think this is one of her performances that she did recently. But I love Mariah. She's amazing.
Great. Okay.
Here we go.
From a window.
Hello, my friend. What an honor to get to contribute to this celebration for you. I think about you so often, and I consider myself very, very lucky to have you in my orbit, however distant the planets may be. The orbit still stays strong, the gravitational pull is strong, and your gravitational pull is among the strongest I have ever seen. So please enjoy this little video submish, this little tune, and know that you are just so loved and so admired. Be well, my friend.
I have watched three seasons from my window, watched the world go slipping by on a screen of sky. I have been companion to my window as I memorize the canopy. By what I see, the chronology in a
so moving.
That is so beautiful.
Mariah's voice is just like it soars and soars and soars like a eagle.
It's so incredible.
Yeah.
I wanted to say thank you to everybody who participated in it. We were going to show one more video, and we've been trying to kind of get it working all night, but it was just like the
which video was it?
It wasn't playing, unfortunately. Okay, I'm going to send that to you, and we're going to post it along with this video later.
Great.
Because we're going to post the whole thing.
Great.
But if you haven't been watching, people, whoever logged off, if you missed part of it, we're going to post this whole thing after the fact. So, and we're going to post another video with that, Obi. You'll be happy to see it. Unfortunately, it didn't play. I don't know why.
Okay, cool.
The tech tonight has been kind of off and on, but that's all right. I just wanted to spend these last few minutes just saying thank you to everybody who kind of participated and everybody who kind of helped out behind the scenes. A couple people from my side, Babine, thank you so much for spreading the word. Trapper, thank you so much for helping out and spreading the word. All the singers, to everybody who participated, it's so amazing that you did this, and it's so nice. To Jenny, thank you so much. I'm so happy that we got to connect again and that you got to help out, and then everybody who donated, of course. And then finally, thank you to Irvis Zico, who helped the tech behind the scenes. Probably not his fault that this
might
happen. He has never experienced this before, and I think that the webcam is connected to it. I think something malfunctioned. So, but anyway, thank you to everybody who participated. Obviously, thank you, Obi, kind of the man of the hour. I'm so happy that I got to do this with you and connect with you.
Yeah, you know, thank you, Jamie. I just feel like it's the beginning of a great friendship with you. You know, I feel like there's no accidents really in this world. And it's great to be connected to a fellow artist like yourself that's, you know, just getting started. I mean, obviously so much experience your whole life already, but you're just emerging and emerging and emerging. And, you know, and I really feel, you know, to everyone that's listening that, you know, the arts are really important, you know, and I urge us all to support the arts. You know, artistic expression is a lot of why I'm alive right now, you know, I think it's really something that can help uplift us as a planet, you know, and we will get through all of this. Everything that we're faced with, and these hurdles and these obstacles and these challenges, you know, we have a lot of power in togetherness. You know, I think that's really the key moving forward, is that we have to pull together as a species, you know, as a planet, as one, knowing that we're all connected, we're all related, we're all different parts of the same fabric, the same tapestry. You know, and if we recognize that and pool each other's resources, there's no reason anyone needs to be treated less than equal. And it just, again, it doesn't matter what your circumstance is, we can all get through this together. So this is a time for positivity. This is a time for hope. And, you know, I spent a lot of time recently listening to the words of Dr. King, of Martin Luther King, whose energy I think we really need right now. We need to dream big right now. We need to dream really, really big collectively and imagine the unimaginable and dream the undreamable. We can do it. We can do it.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Obi. Thank you so much. And thank you to everybody that watched. Have a great night.
Have a great night.